tail words. Every question is accompanied by a tail word. Either it is comment, or it is examine, or it is evaluate. So my humble suggestion to all of you, that content is more or less same. Everyone is writing the same. No one is going to write very historical aspect, because this is already general studies paper, not an optional paper. But every question is accompanied by a tail word. That is the essence of the question. Suppose there, what is your good name? Deepak. The question is evaluate Deepak, examine Deepak, analyze Deepak, discuss Deepak, critically examine Deepak, illustrate Deepak, assess of Deepak, assess for Deepak. Ultimately, content is same. Deepak is Deepak. Deepak is not going to change. But it is the methodology that is going to change in every aspect, in every question. So in history, most of the words they are using is comment. The comment is basically, if the question is accompanied by the word comment, so UPSC expects that at least you are aware with the tail word, and that is comment or other these type of word. So in this scenario, what happens exactly? Comment means your question should be accompanied by, if comment, when do you make a comment? When you observe someone for a particular period, then you come out with your conclusion that this is the comment, that this is the, you say about someone, are wo chor hai. You do not make a comment in one go. You are observing it, and then you are coming out with a certain conclusion. So if the question is accompanied by the word comment, then either you support with the statement or you negate with the statement. But that should be followed with your certain fact. Suppose that question is partition of India was inevitable. Comment. It does not mean that you start and writing partition. Whether you support the statement, was it inevitable or was it not inevitable, come out with your certain fact and figures. Then make your comment. Observation should be there. Second one, if the question is examined, then you have to write down both aspects. What are the positive aspects? What are the limitations as well? If the question is critically examined, then in the end you have to make the conclusion, what is the position of that statement in the historical aspect. I am just dealing with the history questions, history topics. So this is criteria. Suppose that the question is discussed. Critically examining, in the conclusion part, you have to write down what is the position of the statement in the historical aspect. Critically examining means, where do you place that statement in the historical aspect? Examining, positive and negative both, no problem, along with the limitations. Then, if the question is followed by the word discuss, here you have to write down every aspect about the question. Suppose that the question is discuss the decline of Indus Valley civilization, though they will not ask like a plain question, but I am just making with the example discuss. Here you have to write down what all are the views about the decline in brief, to show the examiner that you are aware with the demand of the question. That's very simple. Explain, then you have to write down, that means you have to substantiate your answers with the suitable examples. These are the few tail words that is always asked by UPSC in the question. And if you are getting the meaning of these one, then your task is very easy.
Rest is up to you. What is the content you have? And the simple aspect of answer writing, that doesn't matter whether you know or not. Read the question in the very first go, then divide the questions, read the question. If you are getting the demand of the question in the very first go, it's very good. If you are not getting the demand of the question, read again, break the question in the parts, and then write down parts wise. That's all. Simple logic, no intro, no confusion, reading should be there. So to begin with, all the important topics that I am going to cover in your this class, you will in the end of the class, after DPR all session, on the last day, you will get all the printed content, topic and all those content would be there. So now, in the part of first paper GS, paper 1, to begin with, I am going to start with the Indian culture aspect. Indian heritage, art and culture. In Indian heritage, art and culture, they have asked the question about the paintings, particularly in the Stone Age. They have also asked the question about painting. So now, painting is not so much important.
You just switch over here, then pottery. Here pottery divides the answer in three parts. To begin with, Indus Valley civilization, because you know, to show the examiner that this is Stone Age. Just make a flow chart to show the examiner that in the Stone Age, this is the Paleolithic Age.
This is the Mesolithic. This is the Mesolithic.
And then
this is
Neolithic. You all know
that the pottery
is coming here in the period of IBC, sorry, Neolithic people.
Here the pottery was
red and black ware.
It was also matte impressed. Followed by
Chalcolithic or Chalcolithic period. Here we have various objects like jhukar, like jhakar. All those objects are here. Then followed by Indus Valley civilization. Here Indus Valley civilization. The pottery is not Indus Valley civilization. Before the Indus Valley civilization, here the pottery is OCP, Bronze Age, ochre colored pottery. And then IVC, here in the IVC, the pottery is black and red, followed by some pottery precursor of PZW, and that is Iron Age, particularly later Vedic period. Clear? This particular period is again black and red, that corresponds to early Aryan period. This PZW, that is of Iron Age, later Vedic period, followed by NBPW, Northern Black Polished Ware, in the Mauryan period.
So this is the chronology of the pottery. Here, beginning with the Neolithic period, handmade pottery, followed by Jhukar and Jhakar pottery. This is a place.
Why this is the name? This is a place particularly. Okay, and then the name is given on the basis of that, because one popular point of this period is Jorvik, which people might have heard. So that culture is referred as Jorvik culture, and the pottery is named on the basis of place. Understand?
Followed by black and red again, corresponds to early Aryan period, then later Vedic period, PZW, and then Northern black polished ware corresponds to the modern period. Clear? Here, one particular aspect is there, that is red polished ware that is found in Gujarat contemporary to this. This OCP is important because recently one of the objects of this OCP is discovered from Saharanpur, district of Uttar Pradesh, and it was in news. So therefore, they can interrelate on pottery. Clear? Whatever you write doesn't matter, but at least show the examiner first that you are well aware with the chronological development of pottery in the ancient India. Then content is more or less same, handmade bowls, jars. Painting is there here in the IVC. Inside the painting is like this, outside black, and inside some reddish aspect is there. In most of the cases, plain. We have some references of geometrical design as well. Clear? Then this is one of the richest pottery, PZW, painted grey ware as the name suggests. Clear? And then northern black polished ware that shows a higher life style, living standard of the modern period, was continued in the later modern period as well. Clear? 2 points on the paintings, it is there. Just I am giving you an idea. In the lower Paleolithic again, no painting. In the middle Paleolithic, because Paleolithic is in three parts, lower Paleolithic, middle Paleolithic, and then upper Paleolithic. In the lower Paleolithic, no reference of painting. In the middle Paleolithic, no reference of painting. In the upper Paleolithic, first reference of painting is there, and that is from Bhimbetka. Now the very simple aspect is there, that what type of painting they will do. Just apply your logic that this is upper Paleolithic age. This corresponds to roughly the period they started to use their hands. So now what will they do? They will do the painting on their walls. Wall is not there. They were living in the cave. They were living inside the stone. So they started to painting on the stone. Now the question arises, what they will paint? Simple, they will paint whatever they will see. Whatever they will see, they are seeing that they are performing hunting, they are performing fishing, so they will paint the day-to-day event. And then the color as far as is concerned, the simple very aspect, stone is there, so limestone is there, so white color is very much obvious. As far as the culture goes, they have the reference of hematite. Hematite is basically the iron ore, and that is the color is something like reddish color. So now they also started to use the red color. Now as you know that red and white mixture is there, so the third color they are also using. So generally yellow, red and white color they were using. As far as the local life is concerned, all the events of the local life was also painted, like women, like children, like dancing. Clear? In the animals, all the animals that they were aware were depicted. Paintings, basically hunting scene was the dominant theme. Clear? Simple painting in the ancient period, particularly in the stone period. Then coming forward, IVC, we have such no any difference of painting. The houses, whatever we have, generally were plain, hardly they were decorative. Followed by Vedic period, no such painting difference is there.
In the later Vedic period, we have the reference of painting on the pottery. They are painted. And then in the modern period, we have a painting, not as such painting, that painting of Yaksha and Yakshini were there on the walls. Clear? So this chronology is there. It starts from there and ending at this point. Now, second aspect that I am going to deal with here is, after this, one topic is there. I am expecting since last 2 years that they will ask, but why they are not asking, I don't know. Again, gentlemen, modern art. See, here modern art, you know, again, pillar, stupas and all these things. No, I am not going to deal with that aspect. I am going to deal with the aspect of the influence on modern art. The influence on modern art is my the core theme. Now let us begin with modern art first, basic idea. Point number one, that modern art is a departure from the traditional, wooden art. Traditional wooden art. Point number two, general nature I am discussing, or you can say general characteristics I am discussing about the modern art. Second point is, gentlemen, that this modern art represents beginning of a new tradition, and that is stone art. This stone art was a very high technological development as far as the modern period is concerned. Third point, if you see, you can say that it had the patronage of court. So it developed in the form of court art. Court art means patronage given by the state. We have the reference of no individual effort. We have the reference of the effort made by the state, be it inscription, be it stupas. Clear? Now, influence. First of all, we see art. Example is pillar. Example is pillar. So you all are well aware with the modern pillar is there. Monolithic. Single stone, and here any capital is there. This is either lotus shaped or bell shaped, as you know very well. This is a part of the lotus, isn't it? This is capital. Now, debate is there. What type of debate is there? That there was Achaemenian or Iranian influence on modern art. So just to show the examiner whether you support this statement or not is based on certain fact and figure. Point number one. Modern art, here I am just showing you some points, and here I am showing you some points of Achaemenian or the Iranian art. Modern art, single stone is there. Use of single stone means that is monolithic. But as far as the Achaemenian pillar is concerned, we have so many joints are there. These all are the joint. So first difference is this. Second difference is, again in the modern art, this is plain pillar, whereas this Achaemenian art is having like, see, two basuri type ka structure isme hame dikh raha hai. Third one, difference is, as far as the moral pillar is concerned, this is something like plain pillar. But if we see the Achaemenian, we have a reference of some pillar having base like this. These are the some differences between the Mauryan pillar and the Iranian or Achaemenian influence. So on the basis of this, it can be clearly stated that as such no influence is there. They can also observe the impact of Mauryan art. Impact of Mauryan art is in three fields. Impact, one is in social field, second one is in economic field, and third one is in political field. Impact of Mauryan art. Impact of Mauryan art. In the social field, see the impact, development of a new kind of technology. Development of a new kind of technology. When a new kind of technology is coming, then this is creating various type of opportunity. Undoubtedly, then this opportunity is going to create a number of employment. This employment undoubtedly is going to affect the economic aspect of the Mauryan period. Not only this, a new kind of this Mauryan art represents influence of religion as well. Influence of religion as well means the religion was popularized. We know very well, for the example, stupas, propagation of Buddhism. Propagation of Buddhism, so this also popularized the influence as religion as well. In the political field, what is the influence? See, with the help of the Mauryan art, for the example, inscription, the king is addressing, directing to the state, means direct communication with the subject. And when direct communication with the subject, gentlemen, here we have a reference only in the inscription that Ashoka says, "All subjects are like my son." This is not a simple statement. This shows by this way, he is trying to show parental outlook. Parental outlook. This is a very, very important characteristic influence of impact of Mauryan art. Clear? Now, stupas are also there. After this, development of stupas in ancient India. Development of stupas in ancient India. Here, you just show the examiner what is the chronological development first. Gentlemen, beginning of stupas is in the Mauryan period, as you know. Particularly, here the stupas are coming. We have a reference of, bataunga abhi, that Ashoka built 84,000 stupas. Even before that, we have a reference when Buddha died and his remains were divided in 8 parts, and on those 8 parts, stupas were built. Later on, Ashoka is coming and then digging out of those all stupas and then constructed. It is said that 84,000 stupas were built by the Ashoka. But you have to write down in the exam which a bit underlined historically does not seem truth. Jo ki itihas ke nazar se sahi pratit nahi hota hai. Ye aapko exam mein dikhana padega. Yes, we have a reference of the oldest stupas, and that is at Piparahwa. And then as far as the Ashokan time is concerned, we have the reference of stupas of Sanchi and then Sarnath. Then in the later Mauryan period, that means if suppose that this is the period of 300 BC to 200 BC, then 200 BC onwards, we have to show the examiner that this is stupas. One is particular there, the Sungas. Then after the Sungas, we have the reference of Satvahanas. Then after the Satvahanas, we have the reference of Ikshvakus. All these people are there. We have to show the examiner that Sunga constructed 45 the stupas, point number one. Point number two, gateway was installed. Satvahanas are there. Nagarjun, Konda is one of the place. Amaravati is one of the place where the stupas were built. Here Ikshvakus are there. One name is missing that you do not know. The name of the place is Ghantsala. The name of the place is Goli. These are the places where we have a reference of stupas as well. In the later Mauryan period, even one name I missed here, the name of Kaniska is also important. Clear? And the name of stupa that was built by Kaniska here nearby in the northwest, the name of stupa is Sah Ji Ki Dyohi. Sah Ji Ki Dyohi. Let's see here coming. After the later Mauryan period, we have Gupta period onwards. In the Gupta period onwards, we have to show the examiner that there was not elements of continuity, there was a decline in the stupas. Hardly we have a reference of any stupa except one. Clear? So now you have to also show the examiner here what was the design of the stupas. Design of the stupas were there, 84,000 stupas, and then here gateway, railing, fortification, Satvahanas, Nagarjunakonda, Amaravati, Ikshvakus, Ghantsala, Goli, Kaniska, Sahaji Ki Dhori, and then decline. Clear? Please show this flow chart in the exam, in the particular portion where the question is chronologically asked, in the historical history part. Because that will show the examiner that you are aware with the chronological development. Because in the history, three characteristics are there. Number one, there is time. Number two, there is period. And number three, there is always elements of changes and continuity. Nothing new is going to take place abruptly. Everything whatever is continued from the previous part is there, though along with some changes are also there. So this is about development of stupas in ancient India. One more topic you can add here. Development of chaitya in ancient India. Development of chaitya in ancient India as far as is concerned. Again, the beginning is Mauryan period. Now see here. Initial chaitya structure is very important here. In the initial, you know, this is the chaitya, this is the place, entry gate, gateway, or this is also called torana. Inside they are brick is used. What I want to say here, harmika, what I want to say that here 1, 2, 3 flags are there representing the three aspects of Buddha. Buddhism, Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha. Gentlemen, this is the stupa of Mauryan period. If I say the Mauryan period means 300 BC to 200 BC, I am roughly talking. But here, in the later Mauryan period, that is the chief characteristic of the stupa is that whereas in the Mauryan period, there was less ornamentation, here in the later Mauryan period, there was a greater ornamentation. Use the word here. There was a greater ornamentation as far as the comparison is concerned with the Mauryan period. Hello. Here, just show the examiner three aspects are there. Here this is seven. Here this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7 aspects are there. Here this is called the Chhatra, as you know popularly, and here it is called Chhatravali. Here it is called Chhatravali. Clear? Vriksh are also used here. Vriksh are also used here. Vedi is also there. Vedi is also there. Harmika is also there. But the ornamentation and the number of Chhatras will increase, and now they are called Chhatravali. Now then, so the examiner that in Gupta period we have a reference of decline of the stupa, sorry, Chaitya architecture. But please show the chronological development. Clear? So now painting, they have asked, but still we have revised roughly, briefly. Then pottery. Now modern art, influence on modern art. Then impact of modern art, cave architecture, sorry, stupa architecture, and then Chaitya architecture. Cave architecture they have asked just last year, so again they are not going to touch this aspect. Now, as far as culture is concerned, a very important aspect was there, Karnataka election held, Lingayat, isn't it? So for us, Lingayat is one of the important aspects it can be. Though historically if you see, then the Lingayat goes back to the 800 AD. Initially we have a reference of Shaivism. Initially we have a reference of Vaishnavism as well. So Vaishnavism, Shaivism. The followers of Vaishnavism, when this reached in South India in the form of Tamil Bhakti, it got developed in the form of Alwar. And then Shaivism, when reached to the South India in the form of Tamil Bhakti, it was known as Nainar. We have a reference of total 63 Nainars. Okay? The original, this Shaivism is represented in a book known as Adam. And there are total 28 Adams, it is said. And those Adams were written by Acharyas, known as Saivachar. Actually, it is said that in the Karnataka, during roughly 800 AD, one aspect emerged in the Shaivism that is known as Lingayat. That is known as Lingayat. It is said that the founder was Basav. Founder was Basav in the Kalchuri region of the Karnataka, and it is said that the ruler was Vishal. They used to wear the ling phallus in their अपने गले में वो पहनते थे. ये एक सेक्ट है Shaivism का. Shaivism के कई सारे सेक्ट हैं. Pasupati is there, Kalamukh is there, Kapalik is there, Kashmir Shaivism is there. So one such is Lingayat. Earlier it was developed as an in opposition to the Hinduism, because Hinduism were strictly following the strictly ritual sacrifices, particularly Brahmanical dominance. So it, they worship Shiva, but it developed as an anti-Hinduism. The political overtone that is there, it got developed after 1980s particularly. So one aspect is very important about Lingayat, that it is anti-Hinduism, and particularly the dominance of the Brahminical culture, that is caste discrimination and other aspects. Though they worship Shiva. So since Lingayat was there in the news, so the question can be either on the Lingayat directly, what is there or what are the features, or they can ask about development of Shaivism here. So development of Shaivism, then go to the year that the reference is roughly in the 600 BC to 300 BC, because we have a reference in the 300 BC when Megasthenes is coming, then he is writing that worship of one Krishna is there and worship of one Shiva is there. And then later on we have so many reference of Shaivism as well. So development is under 600 BC to 300 BC. But particular development of various sects, it is said that roughly 100 AD, the first sect that developed was Pasupat cult, that was developed by Lakulish, and his place of birth is Kavya Rohar, somehow nearby Gujarat.
that gives the concept of pati, pashu and path. Pati is here Shiva, pashu is here the human being, and path is here that we all are in bondage. That if we have to get liberation, we have to follow or we have to worship Shiva. Then after Pasupat cult, then Kalamukh, the leftist organ of the Shaivism, the same is Kapalik, eating in the skull and all those things are there, and then pronouncing Hu-Hu-Ha-Ha-Hankara, that is the word they pronounce, so please write down H-U-Hu-Ha-Hankara, these words should be there. Then Lingayat is there, and then after the Lingayat, that one Kashmiri Shaivism is there. Kashmiri Shaivism is also known as Pratyabhinga, P-R-A-K-I-A-B-H-I-N-J-A, Pratyabhinga is there. And then, please also mention some difference about Southern Shaivism, particularly this one, Shaiva Siddhanta, Agam, 28 Acharyas, and their Veda, Pancham Veda, Dravid Veda ke naam se jana jata hai, one book is there, that is known as Pancham Veda, or the Dravid Veda. We have also the difference of Shaivism during 600 BC to 300 BC. 300 BC is the period that roughly corresponds with the Sangam age in South India. In the Sangam age, we have a reference of Shaivism as well. Clear? So this is all the aspect about Shaivism. Next, moving towards culture, cultural aspect is that one. Now painting is done, now pottery is done, now Mauryan is done. Now after Mauryan, all those cave architecture and stupa architecture in the ancient India, stupa architecture, and then now the Shaivism, Lingayat, religion-wise. Now then, sculptural art. In the sculptural art, they can ask the difference about the connecting together Mathura art along with the Amaravati art. So please write down few points that you can miss in the exam, just 2-3 points. As far as the Amaravati art is concerned, you all know about the Mathura art. Mathura art is an indigenous art developed in India around the region Mathura. It was the Jainas, particularly the Jaina merchants, who promoted the Mathura sculpture, and it was the Mathura sculpture in which the first image of Jaina Tirthankar was formed. Then you have to show the examiner that how Mathura art is very much different from the Gandhara art, that aspect. Theme, as far as theme is concerned, Mathura art focus on spiritualism. Along with the spiritualism, practicalism is also there. And popular art is also depicted. All the stories associated with the previous birth of Buddha, that is Jatakal, is also mentioned in the Mathura art. Write down about Amaravati art. This all you know about Mathura art. And Mathura art, along with the Buddhism, we have also reference of Shaivism. And we have also reference of Vaishnavism. We have also the image of Vishnu. So don't take only Buddhism as well. Clear? Mathura. Then Amaravati art feature is that it developed in Amaravati region, and that region corresponds to the Satvahanas, Andhra region, and promoted by later on Ichhwakus. Time period is later Maurya, 200 BC to onwards, particularly 200 BC to 100 BC. What is the material? Write down material in the Amaravati art. White marble. Animal is depicted. Human being is depicted. Somehow we have a reference of sense of movement and energy. Symbolic representation of Buddha's life. In most of the places except two places. In most of the places except two places, Buddha is represented by a symbol. And these two places Buddha is personified. In most of the places Buddha is represented as symbol. Now, gentlemen, in all the stupas, just like in our temple, we
here is a round one part that is known as Pradakshinapath, revolving around the temple. So please write down. It has Pradakshinapath. Hello, and except the Pramavati Yard, only one stoop is there, Sachi, which has Pradakshinapath, except that no one stupa has Pradakshinapath. So please write down. It has Pradakshinapath like Sachi. Some references are intense emotions are also there. Both secular as well as what? Secular aspect is also represented along with religious aspect. And listen, later on, the sculpture of the Amravati art was followed by the Churas and Pallavas. Please write down. Later, the Amravati school style got transformed into Pallavas and Cholas architecture. Clear? Then temple architecture, you are aware, Nagara style, the Davidian style and the Besara style. Nagara style beginning with the Northern India, reference is the Gupta period, Dasavatar temple, and that Dasavatar temple is at Deogar, Jhansi, and then we have so many references of the temples. Even we have the reference of the temple of bricks, made with the bricks, Kanpur, Bhitargaon temple. And then this type of style that started to develop, to take place in the Gupta period, is representative of Nagara style. And in the Nagara style, the temple architecture, you know very well that this is the temple, and here somehow the chief god is there, which is known as Garbhagriha, and here this is like the structure known as Sikhar, and this, and here we have an ambulatory, and this is our Pradakshinapath, and this is some stairs. Coming here, this is the prayer hall, people are sitting. Pata hai na? Important kya hai? Agar kabhi temple architecture ki baat aaye, to begin with your answer, that sabko pata hai ki Gupta period is the period that first time we have a reference of temple. But to show the examiner that first time we have a reference of temple in 100 BC, in Rajasthan at Nagaur, this will sure touch your mark at least. First reference of, please write down like this in the exam, that though we have a reference of temple architecture from Gupta period, and first temple is Dasavatara, Deogar, whatever you want, you can write, but please write down that, but with the underline, we have the first reference of temple in 100 BC in Rajasthan at Nagaur. At Nagaur. And then the Nagara style. Then you have to also bifurcate this Nagara style in three aspects. That Khajuraho temple is the part of Nagara style. Odisha style is also the part of classification of Nagara style. Khajuraho, Odisha, and then one Solanki is also the classification of Nagara style. Khajuraho, built by the Chandelas, you all know very well, during 900 to 1000 AD. In Odisha style, the very famous is the Kodang Sun Temple, that is also known as Black Pagoda, Puri Temple, Jagannath Temple, and here Solanki, one more Sun Temple is there, known as Modhera. This Modhera Sun Temple were also built by the Solankis. Here in the Odisha, one is Kodang Sun Temple, that is also known as Black Pagoda. This is all about Nagara style. Then Dravida style, you know, No need to show the examiner that this has so many aspects, development. Show the theme. Show the design. So that you are aware what is the structural differences between all the students. Then Dravidized style. In the Dravidized style, we have a reference of chief guard along with the chief guard. Some guards are there on the corner. All this you know. Then the climax of this Dravidized style is Chola architecture, which is basically the development of the fifth stage of the Pallava architecture. To begin with the Mandap style and then Rathas. The biggest is the Dharmaraj and the smallest is the Draupadi and then Rathas climax is the Chola architecture. Theme is important here. Clear? Then Indo-Islamic culture, homogeneous culture. One question is very pertinent here that you go and also prepare about in detail, not detail, Sufism and Bhaktism. Don't you think it can be a good question? How did Sufism or role of Sufism in creating a composite culture in India? So we have to pick from Bhakti and Sufi what is common. Both are focusing on monotheism. Both are focusing on social equality. Both are denouncing the caste, isn't it? And somehow both are creating a composite culture. This type of words we have to take into account. So Bhaktism and Sufism. Then rest is okay. Now, then coming off modern India part. In the modern India part, 2017, last year, expecting the question in the prelims on Champaran, but this year it was there. So again go for a question on the Champaran as you know. So why only Champaran? Choose like this. 2017 is the year and Champaran 100 year is there. So Champaran is associated with whom? Mr. Gandhi, uncle, Hamare Honorable. Now see Gandhi, so his South African experiment. In the South African experiment, all the 4 points that he started, how did he learn Satyagraha? What is the meaning of Satyagraha? And then coming to India, his Champaran, and then why only Champaran? Go also for Kheda, and then why is stopping at only Kheda? Go for Ahmedabad as well. Just 2-3 points you have to remember, otherwise rest is the same. Here in Champaran, again the Tinkatiya system. As you know, Tinkatiya system, that they were already in the contract, isn't it? And you all know, Kheda, enhancement of the revenue, wild failure of the crop, and then Kheda Satyagraha, and then Ahmedabad, mill worker strike, because the bonus was given, when the plague was there, now after the plague, bonus was taken away, but here he asked, those workers were asking that the inflation is so high, isn't it? So that type of bonus was not, shall not be taken back. While the mill owners were not ready to compromise. In this movement, one of the great industrialists was someone, his sister, Amsuya Ben, was with the Gandhi in this struggle. Clear? So now why after just Ahmedabad stopping here?
Because Rohrak, Champaran is his first
Satyagraha, but first political Satyagraha is Rohrak Act. So hum isko kyun chhod de?
Rohrak Act, the question is why? Answer is, you know,
after partition of Bengal, 1905 onwards, rise of revolutionary terrorism in India. So government of, and at the same time, First World War was there. So government of India, at the same time that one act was there, and that act was secret act. Time was over, so government of India was trying to overcome with this type of revolutionary activities. So therefore, under the Justice Sidney, appointing a committee, and that committee is coming out with a report. As you know, no appeal, no dalil, no appeal, no trial, and then punishment, all those things are there. So important is Rohrak Act. And then from here, Gandhi called upon the Satyagraha, which is described as the first political Satyagraha.
But this satyagraha was opposed by Jainism. This satyagraha was opposed by Jinnah. This satyagraha was opposed by Malviya. Why?
On the ground that now when government of India is going to bring some reform, at the same time doing this type of political hartal or satyagraha would not be good.
And you know us, after that, coming back to where? Lucknow, he was invited to come to Punjab. Now coming here nearby Palwal, 6th of the April, Gandhi was arrested, and then Jallianwala Bagh massacred.
Then Jallianwala Bagh massacred, and then you know this is a time that Khilafat movement was there. But all this topic is important. Why only Champar? What is the linkage? So, इसलिए इन सारे टॉपिक पे दो-दो लाइन, तीन-तीन लाइन यू हैव टू वर्क.
And then here Khilafat movement, Jallianwala Bagh, and result is non-cooperation movement.
Here important is Gandhi, non-cooperation movement. Here his style is important. Struggle truth, struggle is important.
That is very important. His strategy they can ask a question.
Okay? So how struggle, and then how truth, and then how again struggle is there.
Clear? So on.
Now link.
NCM and coming on TDM.
Instead TDM, background,
Gandhi meeting, sorry,
Gandhi's 11 point, demand, not accepted by anything, and then Gandhi resorted to civil disobedience movement. At this time, discussion was going on in London on the report of the Simon Commission, popularly known as Round Table Conference. Congress did not participate. Round Table Conference 1, Round Table Conference 2 was about to take place, and British government was under pressure to call upon the Indian National Congress to being as a major party. So here Gandhi Irwin Pact is there, 5th March 1931. All those 11 points were not accepted. Two clauses were reduced, that all the political prisoners should be released, all the revenues would be not collected, जो collect हो चुके हैं that would be not refunded. ये दो मुद्दे थे, issues हुआ था, and then Gandhi Irwin Pact, and then participation of Gandhi in Round Table Conference 2, and then going to London, coming back, and then making a statement that I asked the bread, but in return of that I was given the stone, and again relaunching of tea. Clear? So here this aspect is important. And now after this, this year one controversy was there last year. Tipu Sultan Jayanti was there. So here again it be a question on Tipu Sultan, that Tipu Jayanti and the controversy. The UPSC always avoid to ask any controversial question, but since it is associated with the modern history part, so it can be here. It was again this year very much in news after the completion of 100 year of Bhima Koregaon battle, isn't it? You all are aware that every year on the 1st January, more and more people are collected in Maharashtra to celebrate that Bhima Koregaon. What is the story? That you know it is associated with the Bajirao Peshwa III, and in his army so many people were there that were belonging to Mahara community, and they fought together, though no one was victorious, neither the Britishers nor these. But even after that one, since third Anglo-Mysore war, the Britishers were the victorious, so therefore a pillar was constructed. And these Maharas community, earlier they were also even in the Shivaji's army as well, and then later on in the Peshwas as well, but later on they were regarded as the low caste and all these things were there. So something about this Bhima Koregaon, it can also be a good question. As far as the revolt and rebellion is concerned, Paika rebellion, it is also important for us, because you know causes for revolt and rebellion are same. See, Britishers are colonial ruler, their policies are colonial in nature. If the policies are colonial in nature, be it social policy, be it political policy, be it economic policy, clash of interest would be there. If clash of interest would be there, discontent would be there. If discontent would be there, revolt or rebellion is the very much outcome of this discontent. Clear? That means clash of interest is the single cause
behind all those revolts and rebellions and discontent, class of interest, root is that the Britishers were the colonial ruler, so their all policies were colonial in nature. Class of interest, for example, tribal revolt, making forest law, they were enjoying the forest, now you are imposing some certain laws, they were not allowed to use the forest produce and all these things, beginning of tribal revolt, beginning of civil rebellion means the story goes back to the Velu Thampi Diwan, Travancore, isn't it? The first one though we have the reference of Sanyasi revolt 1773, just after the 1 year of the establishment of British rule over Bengal by the Warren Hastings 1772. Why the Sanyasis revolted? Because earlier they were roaming free here and there. Now they started to take in, to take money. So they revolted. Class of interest. Yeh tak tum free ghumte the, kisi ne roka toka nahi, who are you? Kya maang rahe ho? This is that. So class of interest. Diwan Velu Thampi revolt. Civil revolt, peasant revolt, revenue enhancing, they are not able to pay, tribal revolt, forest laws, this is the reason all those tribals called them bhikkhus, foreigners who are there. All these Britishers were called upon by the tribals what? Bhikkhus. Isn't it? So all these aspects are there in the modern India as far as it is concerned. You also prepare some aspects on some personalities. Write down some personalities that you can go for. In the personalities, you again please go and prepare about last year, 125th anniversary was there last to last year, so the question was about the views, Gandhi vis-a-vis Ambedkar, isn't it? So again, you as you know that the same time Subhash Chandra Bose file was so much in news, but UPSC did not ask any question. So here again you can go Gandhi vis-a-vis Subhash Chandra Bose. Ideological difference or ideological conflict or ideologies. Clear? You can also go work something about Swadeshi movement. Swadeshi movement particularly how it was a revival of the Indian culture. Because self-reliance was though the focus, then you have to show how the development in Indian art, Avanindranath Tagore broke the western boundaries and first time the indigenous art was there. National schools were set up. So cultural aspects, how the revival, how the first time the women came out of the seclusion of the door of their houses, how the cultural revival, how the social boycott was there. So how it was a cultural revival, not on the partition of Bengal. So they see movement as a cultural revivalism and that provides a great impetus to the future Indian national movement. Do you agree? Substantiate your answer with the suitable example. That means linking here how it gave an impetus to the movements. Clear? So this is there. Next is one important topic is there about the relevance of Panchseel. How do you consider relevance of Panchseel in the modern time? See, this year one question can be on Buddhism and Jainism. Why? Because this year one question was there in the prelims, because that Jaina celebration was there. So here they can ask why Buddhism spread outside while declined in India, as well as about Jainism that popular in India but lost relevance to out but did not spread outside India. Clear? So in that case you have to write down number one the patronage given to the Jainism and Buddhism as well. Number two you have to write down how the ideological deviation from the original one, how the leftist theme started to take place. And the third one is very important point that Jaina was not in so much opposition to the Brahminical character in the in India, the Brahminical character. Most of the themes were more or less like Jainism did not oppose Varna system, isn't it? Jaina accepts Varna system. So somehow Jaina or Jainism incorporated most of the Brahminical aspect in its fold. So therefore it was survived in India but outside could not spread. And Buddhism just vice versa. You have to also mention here in the Buddhism decline that the greatest role was played by the Shankaracharya. defeating most of the Buddhist philosopher and monks. Yes, you have to mention, because his role is very, very important in the decline of the Buddhism in India. One culture is missing, you people are not noticing it. In our syllabus, in history particular, optional, if you see, the word is mentioned, megalithic culture. Isn't it? Megalithic culture. So what is megalithic culture? That megalithic culture in the southern India, that time particularly, use of big, big stone. So if possible, go and make some figure like this one. Topiculus, Menhir. Menhir, here dead body is there, and big. So not only this, we have so many iron objects are there, we have gold is there, we have impression of cow hoofs, we have impression of cow dung, we have reference of settlement, we have also reference of hand axe. The first hand axe is obtained from Pitli Hal, and then the Trikalkota megalithic culture. And that corresponds to the Neolithic culture of Northern India. One more, North Indian society and culture, from Sahitas to Sutras. See here, North Indian society and culture from Sahitas to Sutras means you have to mention here from 1500 BC to 1000 BC, Rig Vedic period, then from 1000 BC to 600 BC, later Vedic period, then from 600 BC to 300 BC, Sutra period. What was the society? Rig Vedic period, patriarchal society, tribal setup, family was the fundamental unit, concept of kinship, not kinship, joint family system. In the later Vedic period, just reversing it, concept of kingship, tribal system got lost relevance from tribal to territorial, concept of kingship is coming, concept of rashtra is coming, concept of network of officials is coming, Sutra period. Dominance of the patriarchal society, dominance of the Brahminical culture, women were further degraded. Get my point? So from Sahitas to Sutras, education as far as concerned, then we have a reference of only three varnas. In the later Vedic period, it is in the later Sutra period that we have the reference of all the four ashramas. It is the later Vedic period that we have a reference of Gotra system. It is the later Vedic period that we have a reference of metaphysics. Rig Vedic people, though they were believer in one God, that means they were monotheist, but since they personified the nature, so automatically they became the follower of polytheism, so many gods. Concept was monotheism, that Ishwar is, God is one, but since they personified the nature, therefore, so many gods came into existence. Clear? Concept of rebirth is coming in the later Vedic period. Concept of Upanishad coming in the later Vedic period. Eight form of marriages coming in the later Vedic period. In the Rig Vedic period, women status was good, women were respectable in high esteem. There were so many learned women, we have the reference of Apala, Ghola, Vishwara, Lopa Mudra. But in the later Vedic period, the women were not allowed, and even their position was degraded. Even they were not allowed for the Upanayan and all those things. Clear? So this is North Indian society and culture from Sahitas to Sutras. Clear? That means two, three line society, two, three line economy, two, three line quality, two, three line religion, showing all the aspects. Big Greek, but one line each. So almost Indian history aspect is we have done. Now, world history. In the world history, French Revolution is still untouched. Like French Revolution was attack on privileges, not attack on property. I am just saying that to begin with, our syllabus is all the important events of 18th century. So the first one, as far as world history is concerned, there is the French Revolution. In the French Revolution, it is still untouched. And very good questions they can ask, that French Revolution was an attack on privileges, not attack on property, role of philosophers, whether direct or indirect, or the bullock cart that was loaded with the grievances caught by the economic crisis, get fired by the economic crisis, or Napoleon was the child of the revolution, though he destroyed the revolution. All these type of questions they can ask. So just I am giving you a brief idea. If you see the society on the eve of the French Revolution, you find out that there were three tiers of society: tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. Tier 1 was compositioning of clergy, tier 2 was nobility, and tier 3 was common man. Clergy enjoying everything, doing nothing, and they were enjoying most of the land of the France. Number 2, nobility, again there was a discrimination, enjoying everything but doing nothing. Third class, overloaded with all those land revenue, along with this tithes, along with this sometimes ecclesiastical dues means religious taxes imposed by the Pope, tithes, corgi. Even so, here you find out that the society inequality, inequality was there. Tier 1, tier 2, tier 3, even in the tier 1 division, higher class of clergy, lower class of clergy. Even in the nobility, higher class of nobility, lower class of nobility, and tier 3 is the common one. Now exactly what happened, that the political scenario was like this, that there was absolute monarchy, absolute despotism was there. Louis XIV somehow good, but could not do much more. Louis XV was very much unable to do, and Louis XVI was totally extravagant and doing the luxurious life. Now participating in the American War of Independence further deepened their economic problem. Now the total and total exchequer was vacant, empty, and now French condition was very much, you can say, economically miserable. No solution is there. What is the solution? Solution is either to enhance your revenue, okay, or go and ask for public debt. Public debt is not available. Now only one option is there. Somehow the corruption should be increased. How the corruption can be increased? Either to expand the revenue base, okay, bringing them who are not paying, or to imposing more who are already paying. On this issue, that bring them who are not paying, they, nobility and clergy, said that no, we are not ready to pay. Third class was already heavy burden with the taxation. King is left with no any option. Calling the meeting of state general, you will be surprised to know, more than 150 years after that, when this assembly was called upon. Here this third tier, that means the common man, that consists of bourgeois and all those merchant, doctor, engineer, professors. Their number was so high, but their voting was less, because that was based upon the tier 1, tier 2, tier 3. They demanded that no, voting should be on the basis of one man, one vote. Because if one man, one vote is there, their number is quite enough, they would be victorious. But the tier 1, tier 2, nobility and the clergy did not accept this demand, that per man, per vote, no. And even the king did not accept. They coming out of that one hall, closing the assembly, calling themselves that they are the national assembly, and started the adopting the French constitution, which is symbolizing the outbreak of the French Revolution. So see here the root cause is inequality, be it between the tier 2, be it between the tier 1, and all together tier 1, tier 2 against the tier 3. That day tier 1, tier 2 enjoying everything, doing nothing, no responsibility. And where tier 3 overburdened with the heavy responsibility and enjoying nothing. So it was basically not an attack on property, it was an attack on privileges that tier 1 and tier 2 were enjoying. So French Revolution was an attack on privileges, not on property. Clear? Because as you know, now the question second comes, why did the revolution only occur in France? Explain, justify, or discuss, or examine. Gentlemen, if you compare the condition of the France on the eve of the French Revolution in comparison to the other parts of the Europe, we find that the condition of France was nowhere different from the other parts of the Europe. For example, serfdom was there, even in France, serfdom was there. If the despot of the other countries were rulers were despot, it is the French ruler was also despot. Okay? Then the question arises, why did the revolution occur in France? You say, sir, it was bankrupt, it was a crisis, calling upon the meeting of National Assembly. I will say, gentlemen, though the state was bankrupt, but the people of France were prosperous. So why did the revolution occur in France? Then the question, the answer of this riddle lies in the history. That in history, if a people are enjoying certain rights, they start to demand certain more rights. It was the French peasants, those who were prosperous, enjoying prosperity, started to demand Yidil Mange more and more. It was the intellectual class that was available after the Britain only in France that provides a fire, impetus, intellectual revolution before the materialistic revolution.
occurred in France.
Yes. Fourth revolution occurred in France only. Clear? Then now, you know, National Assembly drafting of constitution, then reign of terror, assembly, and then legislature is coming, reign of terror. All these experiment is going on. Actually, the people of France were in great morass. What is going on day by day, experiment by experiment? Then they were looking after stability. They were looking after of something, someone who is coming with a promise that he will protect the truths of the French Revolution as well as at the same time will protect the past prestige and glory of the France as well as will incorporate the new France. So they were looking after. It was a Napoleon. So now it is a very perplexing question to read in this answer that the people of France, who were so much intellectual, who gave the word the three concepts, liberty, equality and the fraternity, they surrendered that spot without a murmur.
So the answer of the reason why the people of France surrendered the response without the murder lies in the history of the France and that occurred after the outbreak of the French Revolution. Number one, experiment by experiment.
Number two, people of France were in great morass. Number three, it was not the chance, it was the opportunity that created the ground and Napoleon Bonaparte seized it. How? Napoleon himself says that the crown of the France was lying on the ground and he took it with my sword. फ्रांस का मुकुट जमीन पर गिरा हुआ था और मैंने इसे अपनी तलवार से उठा लिया. What does it mean? It was his mass appeal. It was his discipline that he showed the people of France. And now the people of France surrendered to him. Because it was his mass
appeal. Because
his commitment. He made a commitment.
He made a promise.
Made a statement that I want to govern the people in the manner they want to be governed. That is my point. That means the French people thought, okay, this is the person that will provide the stability. That is the person that will protect the fruits of the French Revolution because already Napoleon Bonaparte had shown his courage, his vigor in the defeat of Italy 1795 as a general, disciplined person, visionary aspect, so people surrender. This statement is in consonant with the statement that Napoleon was the child of the revolution. Had been no revolution, no equality, no liberty, then how can a general man from offshore could rise to the post of the French monarchy? It was the French Revolution that creating the background of equality, that creating the background of liberty, that a common man on the basis of his ability coming, rising through the revolutionary crest and reaching towards the post of monarch. That means this shows that Napoleon was the child of the revolution. But at the same time, Napoleon out of these three, equality, liberty and fraternity, choose fraternity, did not allow liberty. Because he himself said that the French people does not want liberty, they want vanity. So he was very well aware that I am snatching the vanity. At the same time, I should compensate him with certain reforms. So he found so many reforms and snatched the vanity of liberty. Therefore, he destroyed one of the fruit of the revolution, liberty. This is the reason, this and this together is said that Napoleon, though he was the child of the revolution, but he destroyed the revolution. Okay? So, yeh hai pura ka pura French Revolution dohra diya. ठीक है, आई बात समझ ये ना किटी आप वैसलिस में वर्कआउट कर लेना क्रिटिसिज्म हाउ द सीट्स वर देयर इन द ट्रीटी ऑफ वैसलिस यू नो ह्यूमिलिएटिंग ट्रीटी फॉर द जर्मनी इवन ह्यूमिलिएटिंग ट्रीटी फॉर द इटली एज वेल जो इटली वाज अ पार्ट ऑफ द लीग राइट पाथ बट कमिंग आउट ऑफ द पेरिस पीस कॉन्फ्रेंस एज ही वाज अ डिफीटेड नेशन सो अ टाइप ऑफ म्यूचुअल डिस्ट्रस्ट वाज देयर इट वाज द ह्यूमिलिएशन ऑफ जर्मनी दैट राइज ऑफ नाज़िज्म इन जर्मनी एंड हियर इन इट वाज द ह्यूमिलिएशन ऑफ इटली discontent of Italy that creating the background for fascism in Italy. Clear? So then here Nazism, here fascism and ultimately leading towards Second World War. Clear? For the Second World War one topic is also important, policy of appeasement. Policy of appeasement is the scenario after the First World War. What is the policy of appeasement? Policy of appeasement is the policy that was followed by the West
towards the Germany and Italy in dealing with their foreign affairs. And the result is that this policy of appeasement, do whatever you want to do. Certain forces and factors were there behind the policy of appeasement. Number one, no one was ready for war, threat from communism, their mutual interest, and all these together provided the background. Whatever they wanted to do, they did, and finally the time came, attack on Poland, okay, beginning of Second World War. So it was the policy of appeasement. Clear? So do all these things. Topic all you will get in the end of the with printed material. Clear? Quit out? No doubt. Clear? No view. Whatever is truth you have to write down. Whatever we have read. All the sources.
I might have read the Marxist history and English.
No. Whatever basic चीजें जितनी पढ़ी हैं आपने, वो चाहे आप हो या हम हो, जो basic पढ़ा हुआ है ना, ये historiography एक special level पे आती है. ठीक है ना? जैसे for the example, revolt of 1857. Someone says first war of independence. Someone says neither first nor the war of independence. It is not the view that we will like our approach. It is a view that is accepted by the historians among themselves. So Marxist historiography, rationalist historiography, nationalist historiography, colonial historiography, they come at a certain level. For us, general exam answer, suppose that art and architecture, Indo-Islamic culture, homogeneous culture, revolt of 1857, CDM, Quit India movement, here approach is not there, applicable. Because, see, colonial historiography was written to defend the British rule in India. In response to that, during freedom struggle, national historiography was written. After the independence, rationalist historiography was written. Then Marxist came, subaltern approach, history from below. So history from below, they will not write down revolt of 1857 something else. Because history from below what? This history from below, people were exploited. People were having discontent. So it comes at a certain level. In the history, just follow the tail word, number one. If you don't know, write down point wise. Number three, if it is factual, just write down point wise, that's all. No intro, no conclusion. Simple write, just to show the examiner that you are well aware. No need to just write down paragraph, mein nahi likhoge to number nahi milega. सवाल का उत्तर पॉइंट में भी तो हो सकता है. आपने हमसे पूछा, मैंने पॉइंट वन पॉइंट टू पॉइंट थ्री कहके बोलूं या एक पैराग्राफ में बोल दूं, बात तो एक ही है. ऐसा कुछ भी नहीं कि आप नहीं लिखोगे तो नंबर नहीं मिलेगा. ऑप्शन की बात दूसरी होती है, जीएस की बात दूसरी होती है. आप लिखें, अगर आपको आता है तो आप लिखें जरूर. मेरी एक सलाह है, सवाल छोड़ना मत. आए तो ना आए तो, मैं एक मूल मंत्र दे के जा रहा हूं. मेरे सिलेक्शन का भी यही कहा है, मैं आपको तभी और इसीलिए मैं आपको सलाह दे रहा हूँ, सवाल छोड़ना मत. क्योंकि हो सकता है कि एक आध लाइन लिख के आओ, उसमें ही 0.5 कुछ दे दे एग्जामिनर. क्योंकि आप कुछ अलग तो लिखोगे नहीं, कि वो पूछेगा टेलीविजन तो टेररिज्म तो तुम लिखाओगे टेलीविजन. आप एक यू हैव राइट नाउ अटेन अ सर्टेन इंटेलेक्चुअलिटी यू हैव गेन थ्रू द These periods while you are preparing. तो इतनी तो आपके अंदर capability आ चुकी है. The only thing is कि कभी उस तीन घंटे में याद रहता है, कभी उस तीन घंटे में स्ट्राइक नहीं करता, क्योंकि हम अलग ही प्रेशर में होते हैं, ह्यूमन बींग. रिलैक्स, राइट डाउन, बट प्लीज अटेम्प्ट एवरी क्वेश्चन. डोंट एक्सीड द वर्ड लिमिट. इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू बेनिफिट यू एट ऑल. अल्टीमेटली सवाल दूसरा कम करा देगा. ठीक है ना? लेकिन प्लीज सवाल छोड़ना मत, ये मेरी हम्बल रिक्वेस्ट है. सबसे सवाल नहीं समझ में आ रहा है, ब्रेक द क्वेश्चन इन द पार्ट, राइट डाउन पैराग्राफ वाइज व्हाट द प्रॉब्लम. बिल्कुल, अगर फैक्ट है कि राइट डाउन द प्रोविजन ऑफ 2018, सपोज दैट कोई सबमिट हुई, कुछ भी नहीं पता तो आप डोंट राइट डाउन.
ऐसा अगर है तो बिल्कुल एवॉइड कर दो, लेकिन ऐसा होता नहीं है। हिस्ट्री में फैक्ट में जितने भी होते हैं, मतलब अगर बिल्कुल नहीं आ रहा, बिल्कुल सपोज दैट गुप्ता न्यूमिस्मेटिक, यू डोंट नो इन डिटेल अबाउट गुप्ता न्यूमिस्मेटिक, बट ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ योर फिल्म रीडिंग यू नो दे इश्यूड द लार्जेस्ट नंबर ऑफ गोल्ड कॉइन, दे इश्यूड द सिल्वर कॉइन, ऑन द कॉइन ऑफ द समुद्र गुप्ता ही इज सोन दैट ही इज प्लेइंग द वीना, जितना फिल्म में पढ़ा है लिख दो। अब लोग यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू राइट कि गुप्ता क्वाइनेज के अलावा तुम हर्षा का क्वाइनेज नहीं लिख रही हो, गुप्ता का ही लिख रहे हो, लेकिन क्वेश्चन को छोड़ेंगे। इससे बढ़िया है कि फिल्म्स के में जो पढ़ा है उस रिटेन अपनी जो रिटेन रह गया है उसको हम एग्जामिनर को दे दें, ठीक है ना। अल्टीमेटली सी दिस इज ए विन विन सिचुएशन एंड दिस इज अ रिलेटिव एग्जाम। नहीं मुझे हाँ तभी तो मैंने नहीं टच किया, मैंने देखो स्टार्टिंग से वो चीजें टच कर ली हैं जितनी भी चीजें इंपॉर्टेंट हैं, और जो जो पूछा है लास्ट से उसको मैं स्किप कर गया हूँ क्योंकि रिपीट तो नहीं करेगा, इसलिए मैं छोड़ दिया। लेकिन हाँ आपके उसमें जोड़वा दिया है, जो शीट मिलेगी ना उसमें मैंने ऐड करा दिया है, बहुत सारे टॉपिक उसमें ऐड है क्योंकि दो घंटे में सब नहीं चीज कर सकता, बहुत सारे टॉपिक्स उसमें ऐड, न्यू इंपीरियलिज्म इंपीरियलिज्म जोड़वा दिया है मैंने, रिलेवेंस ऑफ यूएन देयर इफ पॉसिबल गिव द फ्लो साइंटिफिक रिप्रेजेंटेशन शुड बी देयर बिकॉज दिस इज विजिबल इवन इन ब्रीफ टाइम, इफ यू हैव नो टाइम यू कैन शो द एग्जाम दैट यस यू आर एटलीस्ट अवेयर विद द कंटेंट, ड्यू टू द पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ टाइम यू आर नॉट एबल टू पुट इट डाउन, दैट्स ऑल, बट एज फार एज पॉसिबल इफ यू हैव टाइम इवन गिव द साइंटिफिक रिप्रेजेंटेशन देन राइट डाउन, इट इज ऑलवेज इन एवरी ऑब्जेक्ट इट इज going to give you at least 0.5 marks extra in comparison to the other one, because presentation matters only in the exam, no one is there, only your copy is there, what is your academic background doesn't matter, what is the presentation that matters a lot. Scientific presentation, yes, if you know the drawing you can go for it, no problem. Nara style, Davada style, Vesara style, Indo-Islamic, arcuate, arc, semi-arc, dome, semi-dome, no problem. Your history sir is waiting. Sorry, geography sir is waiting. Thank you.